relationships. We are in a revival.
A settlement that you had to come to. That my life that God had given me on the planet.
It is but there.
I love the word workout. It
stand
over your wife,
over your children.
The truth is that the work has already always been available.
We know that. Okay. It was how they operated.
Being in God's will. If you've ever experienced going along praying about something and you never got an answer.
Hi, True Divine Online community. It's me, Minister Victoria Mahand, and I am coming live to you today from my own home. We are so glad that you decided to join us on today. You are in for something special, a high energy, spirit-filled worship experience and a powerful and practical word from our own Pastor Stephen Huntley. I'm telling you, you're in the right place and at the right time. But before we get started, I want to offer three tips to you to make the most of your online experience on today. Tip number one, get into a place where you can remove as many distractions as possible. God has a word for you, and I don't want you to miss it. Tip number two, make this online experience fun and interactive. Clap your hands, sing along, grab your notebook and your pen and take notes if you want to. And also, send us a message. Let us know how God is blessing you. And then the final tip number three, it's okay for you to share this information and let someone else know that they can join you online as well and hear what God has to say to them also. All right, that's it for me. I hear the worship songs beginning. Let's get started. Are you ready? I'll see you there.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Come on, he's never failed you before. For change to come, but knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Come on, all over the house, help us sing. Your promise still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
Hallelujah. Well, praise God tonight. What a joy it is for us to come together tonight and sit around the table of God's word. What a joy. Praise God for this opportunity that we have to experience Bible study on this Wednesday night. Father, we love you and we thank you. We thank you for this privilege that we have to serve your people, serve this community, serve this entire globe by way of the internet. So we thank you, Father, for connecting us together all around the world. And we pray, Father, that you would give us wit and wisdom according to your scriptures so that we may be able to share the word, God. And so, Father, we thank you for enlightening us and bringing us to a place of revelation so that we may know during this shift how to make and change our position, direction, and tendencies so that we can come in alignment with your will and purpose for our lives. So we glorify you and thank you for it. It is in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Well, again, welcome to Wednesday Night Bible Study. Thank you for being a part tonight. Over the last 3 weeks, I have shared with you that we are in a shift and we are returning together, but we are expecting greater. We're returning together, expecting greater. Remember, the definition for a shift is a slight change in position, direction, and or tendency. We talked about shifting in our perspective, our position, and our priority. And tonight we'll be talking about shifting where our purpose is concerned. Now this lesson tonight is kind of an attachment to last week's lesson around priority. Remember last week we shared with you that it's so important as we come up out of this pandemic that each of us realize that, you know, we have to attend to and evaluate our priorities, because during the pandemic, a lot of things have really shifted in our lives, and because of that shift, we need to be able to come up out of it running. And a part of that running, that off to the races kind of Christian life, a part of that is making sure we have top right priorities. And so we revisit it where we make sure that God and what he has assigned for our lives and him being Lord of our lives is top priority. And then secondly, we talked about the importance of our families. You know, if you're married, your spouse, then after that comes your children. Then after your children come parents and so forth, so on with your kinsmen and all those other pieces. But those general family pieces are, you know, spouse, children, parents. And we talked about that on last week. So if you haven't viewed and heard the word from last week, it'll be good to go back and listen to that in order to catch up to where we are tonight. Now, one of the things we talked about at the very end of the lesson on last week was the importance of not putting our purpose and vision before God and before our families and those who care about us most, okay? Remember, one of the things I said last week was that God will always give us vision and provision to go along with that vision, and that God has not just given us a vision that will last us throughout our lives, but God has given us enough vision that will need to be inherited, meaning it'll need to be passed on to another generation in order for it to be completed. So that gives us the opportunity to get the right rhythm, the right pace in this life so that we don't lose our priorities and perspective in life and start to put vision and purpose ahead of what God really wants to do in our lives with our families, but not only that, but in our personal relationship with him. I have realized that every success I've had in life, It has its root in my relationship with the Lord. Without the relationship that I have with the Lord Jesus Christ, and by virtue of that with the Father, I realize that I would probably not be a person of vision, purpose, nor would I be a person that seeks to go about achieving things in life. But because of my relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, I've discovered that is the main reason why achieving and succeeding in life is a top priority for me. It is a top priority, but that in and of itself is not the priority of my life. the priority of my life is to make sure that people that are in my sphere of influence are affected by my personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And then out of that, the vision and the purpose and the mandate and the call that God has placed upon my life, it too is centered in and it is motivated and infused by my relationship with the Lord. So nothing that I seek to do in life is outside of God's purpose for my life. I'm a pastor, but not only am I a pastor, but in more specific terms, I'm a pastor of True Divine Baptist Church. And so everything that I'm doing with my life is in respect and regards to that calling, to that calling. But that calling is not greater than my position as a husband or my position as a father or my position as a leader within the confines of those that I influence directly. All of that is so important to make sure we have right perspective around those things. Now, as a result of that, now we can talk about purpose, and now we can talk about vision. Having right perspective, having right position, and having right priority are key elements to putting purpose in its right place. Amen? All right. So we're going to tonight talk about how to shift our purpose, or shifting our purpose. So what is purpose? Purpose is, in a very, very small terms, it is the thing. It is the thing that you have been given as an assignment to do in this life by God. It is the thing, the thing. And I could put things, because there are a lot of things that are a part of your purpose in life. And I guess that would probably be the right way to go about it, is the things you are assigned to do with your life that are given to you by God. But then there is an overall purpose for your life that is centered in God. And that sometimes can escape us, but that's why we have the opportunity to pray about it and to seek God until God reveals what that purpose is in us. And that's individually. That's not being a copycat. That's not being a shadow of somebody else who have previously come before you. There are some types and shadows of men and women of God that have come before you that you can say, well, this anointing and grace on my life is very, very similar to such and such and such. And I think that is biblically okay, because you see, you know, you got Moses and Joshua, you got Elijah, Elisha, you've got John the Baptist and a follow-up of Jesus and so forth, so on. So you got these examples in the Word where there are prototypes that have preceded a man or woman of God, and I think that is biblically in alignment with God's Word. I think it is in alignment with God's Word, okay? All right, so a purpose is the thing or the things that you are assigned to do with your life in this lifetime, okay? All right, so the first opportunity we get tonight to see a shift in a person's life is our great model, Jesus Christ. Remember, a few lessons ago, I shared with you that when we start talking about looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, 2, 3, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, Jesus is the prime example of how we ought to live our lives. So when we start talking about, you know, works of the flesh, and we start talking about purpose, and we start talking about prayer, and we start talking about fasting, or we start talking about ministry, we start talking about being good to people, who do we look to as an example through the Word? We look to Jesus. We look at his life and his ministry to find out what I'm supposed to be doing according to God's will for my life. So Jesus has already set the standard. He's already set the standard, so there's no standard that we're trying to achieve. It has already been set for us, and all we got to do is go about laying aside every weight and sin that so easily beset us, and then watch this, running the race that God has set before us according to the pattern by which Jesus has already laid out for us through his life and ministry. So, hence, we're going to look at his ministry first. We're going to look at his ministerial call and purpose first, so that you can define who God has called and purposed you for as well. All right, so here we go. So here's Jesus' ministry purpose. In Luke chapter 4 and verse number 16 through 21. Luke chapter 4, verse 16 through 21, it says, And Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, meaning he was raised and nurtured and grew up in a little place called Nazareth. And as it was his custom, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. Verse 17 says, and there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. Verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Why? Because the Spirit of the Lord hath anointed me, talking about Jesus, to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent Jesus to heal the brokenhearted, and sent Jesus to preach deliverance to the captives, and to send Jesus to recover the sight to the blind, and sent Jesus to set at liberty those that are bruised, and sent Jesus to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Then verse 20 says, and Jesus closed the book, gave it unto the minister, and then he sat down, and then all the eyes of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And Jesus said this while sitting, and he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Notice in this scripture in Luke chapter number 4, Jesus doesn't have to go about trying to figure out what his purpose and mandate in ministry is all about. No, he found it in the scriptures. He found it in the scriptures. For all of you that are going about life trying to figure out what your purpose and your call is in life, listen, you have to turn to the scriptures. Most of us go about looking at life from a worldly perspective as a Christian. We have to have a biblical worldview. And if you and I have a biblical worldview, that centers us now in looking at life the way God looks at life. Here it is. This is how God looks at life. Just like Jesus, he went, they delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah, and he found the place where it was written about him. That's it. You have to have scriptures to stand on no matter what you say your purpose is. Okay? Now that's important, because remember last week's lesson that we shared with you. Make sure that you've got right priorities, and as you got right, you put things in proper perspective, prioritizing things. Now you're ready for your purpose. But in order to do your purpose, in order to discover your purpose, you have to find it in the Word of God. You have to find it in the Word of God. Yeah. It's in there. It's in the book. It's in the book. And I know it's a beautiful thing when other people can prophesy over your life and declare certain things over your life and in your life, and you take that as the very voice of God. But let me tell you something. It is something totally different when you can discover God's purpose for yourself. I'm talking about Moses in Exodus chapter number 3, finding and contacting God for himself, that he's on the backside of the desert along with God, along with the sheep, and God, through the angel in the bush, the angel of God speaks to Moses and transforms his life. Transforms his life. You know the story. You know it in detail. And I'm asking you that tonight you discover that same type of a personal relationship experience with God to the extent that nobody can change your mind about God's purpose and mandate upon your life. I don't know about you, but that's the place I've always been with God. That when I met God personally, came to know him personally for myself, became a born-again believer, nobody else came to the altar of Christ and for Christ but me and me alone. I didn't come because I was put on a show in a fashion. I came because Christ was preached to me that night, and then out of Christ being preached to me that night,
out of the abundance of a yes to God, I came into salvation. It was out of that experience that you can be guaranteed when you have that experience that you will forever go after God. Yes, things will go wrong, things will go awry, and you'll go off track and you go here, but you never ever lose that fundamental call and purpose and mandate that God has upon your life. And that's what my prayer is for you tonight. My prayer is for you to find in Scripture what your purpose is, and watch this. Sit down with God and watch this. Allow God to minister in you, because here's the deal. People's eyes, just like it was with Jesus, will be fastened on you. They will be looking to see how you're going to live and walk this out. But here's what I want you to know. God will give you strength. He will give you everything that you need to be able to fulfill your purpose in life. So listen, here's the deal. You shift in your purpose tonight. Shift in your purpose. What was is no more. The Bible says that Jesus, in this scripture, that Jesus went in to a place where he was brought up. And that's why the eyes was fastened on him, because to them, oh, this is just Joseph's son and this is Mary's boy, but we don't know him to fulfill scripture. Surely he's not saying that he is the very Son of God. And here's the deal, because you need to know this, that when people's eyes are fastened on you, you have to be willing to be able to handle all that God has called you to in your purpose. Don't allow the eyes, don't allow the nays, don't allow the naysayers to turn you back from what God has called you to. He sanctioned, he called, he purposed you, and he will help you to fulfill every mandate he has on your life, regardless of the season. So we're in the season of the shift, and now we see Jesus going from just being a carpenter's son into real, active, and alive ministry. That's what I wanted you to see tonight. That's what I wanted you to see in this opening scripture about Jesus, how he had to shift from being in the eyes of all the people just a carpenter's son. Listen, the season of carpenter is over for Jesus in this text. The season of being Joseph's son is over in this text. The season of being just Mary's son is over in this text. He now hath declared that God hath purposed for his life, and it required a shift in who he was, and he shifted, and now he's ready to go about doing what God hath called for him. That's my prayer for you this night. That's my prayer for you as you go forth, is that you'll shift out of last season and shift into your new season of purpose. Because last season and all that you did before was great. It brought you to a place. But now it's time for the revelation, the full revelation of who God called you to be. And it's time for you to accept it. And it's time for you to go about completing the task by which God hath called you. Just as Jesus proclaimed his, so must you do as well. Do it publicly. What you were doing privately was good. But now it's time to come forth. Now it's time to come out of the shadows, come from beyond, below the pale, or below the standard where everybody else couldn't see you. Now it's time for people to fasten their eyes on you and watch what God is doing in your life. It's that season. COVID is being dealt with, and it's that season for you to start coming out from the shadows and coming forth as a leader, as an example, as a man, woman of God in the body of Christ. It's that time. And I hope that I'm encouraging you in this season of your life to go ahead and make your shift. Yes, I know you've been in training. I know you've been learning. I know you've been under tutelage. But now is the season for you to come out from under tutelage. Now, this is not for everybody, but this is for somebody. This is for the person who knows that this is the season. You've been talking with God, you've been praying about it, and you've been yearning inwardly, spiritually, and now tonight you're getting this mandate of the word that now is the time for you to shift from the identity of being your parents
to now becoming your own person in the body of Christ, who's going to come forth and be able to fulfill God's purpose and mandate upon your life in this generation. I speak that and declare it over your life. Now, let's go to the second example tonight on shifting our purpose. This is Apostle Paul. It's Apostle Paul. Now, if you will, this is Googleable if you can. I like kind of grabbing all of the historical facts around a text as much as I can. Every text doesn't have a whole lot of history around it, but Apostle Paul's conversion has a lot of historical events that happen around it. So we see that, you know, historically, that, you know, some people say that Jesus died around AD 33. Some says he died around AD 30. Some people AD 29, so forth, so on. I happen to be one of those AD 29, 28ers, all because that Jesus was born, you know, a few years before the end of the BC era, a few years before. So, you know, we know he lived about 33 years. And so we know that it doesn't go beyond 33. So we do know that Paul's conversion was somewhere around AD 36. We know that. We know that based on those who were political figures of the day. So somewhere there about AD 34 to 36. So if Jesus, in, you know, from my perspective of my study of AD 29, to about, you know, 34, 36. We're talking about a five-year gap. So we see that the church had about a five-year sprint on Apostle Paul, about a five-year sprint, meaning Apostle Paul was not a founding member, okay? So because he wasn't a founding member, the standards of what it looked like to be a member of the Hebrew church were already set. That would have been Peter and John and the other of the apostles that would have set those standards for the early church. But here comes a young man by the name of Apostle Paul. Now, he already has his standards. He's a law guy. He's a law guy. He has studied. When I say law, I'm not speaking just like in context to what we consider law now in the United States, but I'm talking about Hebrew law. I'm talking Hebrew law and those things that govern the Hebrew people. So Paul studied under the tutelage of a guy by the name of Gamaliel, okay? And so his studies were based in Hebrew practices, okay? Some people call it Judeo-Christian values, but I like to use the word Hebrew because it's more rooted in their culture, okay? The Hebrew people's culture of the Old Testament text. I hope I didn't confuse you. I hope I gave you enough for you to kind of keep up with me, okay? So, but Paul has been trained in this, okay? He's trained in the Hebrew's way of life ever since he was born into the world. Matter of fact, Paul comes along and talks about, in his defense, that he was a Hebrew of all Hebrews. He was of the tribe of Benjamin, so forth, so on, taught and studied under Gamaliel. So he was imparted into a whole lot about Mosaic law, Ten Commandments, and the other 603 commandments. There's a total of 613 commandments, but you know 10 of them were written on tablets, the others on stone, 10 on stone, the other written on tablets. And so it's a total of 613, and Paul was well versed in this. So Paul's position is to defend everything Hebrew. Remember, our theme tonight is to shift our purpose. So Paul's purpose at this point in the scriptures I'm about to bring out is he is a defender of all things Hebrew law. He is a defender of that. But now, as he is a defender of all things Hebrew law, here comes the church. Here comes John 3:16. For God so loved the world that God gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Verse 17, John 3:17. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So God Father, has this mandate for the Son, a fulfillment of purpose for the Son, and that is to open up all windows and avenues so that all humankind can come into a relationship with the Father. That's the assignment. But Paul, as all the other Hebrew people, were raised up under the old covenant, under the covenant of law. And Paul is defending the law. He's not just going about just, you know, wreaking havoc on the church and killing people for no reason. He's defending something. And the something that he's defending is the Mosaic law. He's defending what was. That's why a shift has to happen. That's why a shift has to happen. Because what was is no more. What was is going to, watch this, it is going to make a slight adjustment so that God can fulfill why he loves humankind, and that is that all humankind might have a relationship with the Father. All right, here we go. Now, let's take a peep here at Paul's conversion. All right, so there are two parts of Paul's conversion. Number one part is he has an old man. I like to define his old man as not Paul, but Saul, okay? This is his birth name. He's Saul of Tarsus. He's Saul of Tarsus, okay? So here he is in Acts chapter number 8. Remember in chapter 7 that Stephen, one of the first deacons of the church, he stoned to death. And those people who stoned Stephen to death laid their coats down at the feet of Saul. Okay, laid him down at the feet. He was the authority figure on behalf of those that were defending the law. Okay, so Acts chapter 8, verse 1 through 4. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea, Samaria, except the apostles. In other words, people just said, oh man, I'm picking up and I'm leaving here. I'm not going to die. I'm picking up and I'm leaving. So these people are in the church. They're in the church, right? So you've got now Paul and those that are part of the law system who are going about and wreaking havoc on the church. Okay? Verse 2 says, and devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentations over him. Verse 3, as for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing or hauling men and women and committing them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Now notice I love verse 4 because verse 4 says, hey, you can't stop the preaching of the word of God. You can't stop it. Now, the thing about the law will always put you in bondage. Any law that you make will always put up different parameters. Now, I'm not saying that you ought not have parameters. Yes, you're going to have parameters no matter what level of freedom you think you might have. In Christ, there are still parameters. There are things that we cannot just jump over in and expect that we're not going to pay the consequences of jumping over into it. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. And so that's what law does. Law always sets a boundary. So Paul is locked in here. Paul is locked in because he's trying to defend something that is passing away. This is what Hebrew writer talks about. The veil that was upon Moses' face wasn't just there. It was a symbol of. It was a speaking to, a passing away of what was. That God is moving us away from that old relationship into a more perfect relationship through Jesus Christ and the very Son of God by virtue of his Spirit. Praise God, praise God. All right, so we see now that Saul had a past. He had a past, but God is shifting him out of that past. Now, when we go over to Acts chapter number 9, we find now the new man, Paul. We find new man, Paul. That's you and I, new man. If any man be in Christ, we are new creatures. We are a new species of being, right? So as we understand that we are a new species of being, we now can go about making the adjustment, the shift in our lives, the slight change that's going to be necessary to fulfill God's purpose and mandate for our lives. And watch what happens in the life of Apostle Paul. Now, this entire story is found in Acts chapter 9, verse 1 through verse number 22. well, I must say verse chapter 9, Acts 9 in its entirety, but I'm going to read verse 1 through 22, and I may just jump around through some of this as well. Listen to this. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. Now remember, he's defending something. He's defending what was. He's defending an old season called the law. And verse 2, he said, and desired him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near to Damascus. And suddenly, here's the shift. Here's the shift in his life. It's called personal relationship with the Father. It's personal. You cannot shift into purpose, shift into anything that is Christian without relationship with the Father. Okay? All right? And now watch this. Here's the shift. And here's the journey. Verse 3, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. He fell to the earth, and he heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you're persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against the pricks. In other words, it's hard for you to, watch this, kick against the shift that I'm doing in the earth realm. I know you're used to doing such and such according to the old way of doing things, the old law. I know it's hard to fathom that through my son, Jesus Christ, that I'm doing something different in the earth realm. I know it's hard to adjust, but listen, you have to shift. You're going to have to make some slight adjustments in how you think, how you view things, and your perspective on what I'm doing in the earth realm. And listen, don't get stuck in a religious framework of last season before COVID. COVID is a change marker. If you want to talk about change, COVID changed a lot of things. It's a life changer. And now we're going to find out whether or not Christians can adapt and become flexible with this change. Because God is doing fresh, new, relevant things today than he did in last season. You know, one of those things is to push us like we are tonight on the internet, like we are now. Before COVID, as a church at True Divine, we weren't doing this in this perspective and reaching people in this perspective. Most of it was happening in this room. But now, because of the change, COVID forced more of our eCampus, more of our social media platforms, and driving the gospel to as many people as we can drive it to around the world. But there are churches that are still resisting this medium by which God is opening up the gospel to. That's what Paul was doing, trying to hold on to something that was. Here it is, you and I have to shift. There has to be a slight change in our position and how we think about it and how we view it and whether or not we're going to engage in what God is doing now, what God is doing now. And Paul is finding it hard, and Jesus says, it's hard for you to kick against my shift. You cannot win when I'm shifting. It's hard to kick against that. Then he goes on and he says, and he trembling and astonished said, Lord, what would thou have me to do? And he said unto him, arise and go into the city, and I've already told, and it shall be told thee what you must do. And the men that were journeying with Paul, Saul at this moment, stood speechless, hearing a voice, but they saw no man. Saul got up from the earth, and when his eyes were open, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him to Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight. He neither ate nor did he drink anything. And there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him the Lord in a vision said, Ananias. And he said, behold, I'm here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, arise, go into the street which is called Straight, and ask, where can you find that guy called Saul of Tarsus? For he is in prayer. Verse 12, and hath seen in a vision a man called Ananias coming in and putting his hands on him that he might receive his sight. And Ananias answered, said, Lord, I have heard of many of this man, and how how much evil he hath done to the saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all those that call on your name. But the Lord said unto him, go your way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Man, packed into that scripture is Paul's purpose. Let me read that one more time. Here, packed into the scripture in verse 15 is his purpose. Listen to it. The Lord said, go your way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name, listen carefully, before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Here's what God said. I'm calling him not only to the people of the scriptures, the Hebrew people, the children of Israel. Not only am I calling him to them, not only am I calling him to kings, glory to God, but I'm also calling him to people that don't know me and have never had a personal relationship with me. Who are those people? The Gentiles. I'm calling him. I'm doing something fresh, new, and cutting edge that Peter is not assigned to. I'm doing something Thomas is not assigned to. I'm doing something that John is not assigned to. And this is it. I'm doing something for the Gentiles. I'm doing something that is cutting edge, and I'm bringing all people. I'm fulfilling John 3:16, and I have called Paul for this purpose. It's Paul that has to make this shift to what God is doing. He's got a purpose, but can he make the shift? And I won't read the rest of this, but you know, Ananias goes on in to discover Saul at that moment, and he prays for him. The scales falls off of his eyes. He spends a few days there preaching in the synagogue. Even the people that were there were amazed. They were like, whoa, this guy is preaching Christ, but just a few days ago, four days ago, he was out persecuting the church. Yeah, that's what I said earlier. You've been under tutelage. You've been under training. Now it's time to be a world changer. Yeah, it's time to come out the shadows. Time to come from the seat under Gamaliel and come out and find your true purpose. Find what God, find your niche in the spirit and watch what God will do. It's not you that will ever carry anything out. Listen to what Jesus said in Luke 4. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. This is what, if you keep reading over here in Acts chapter number 8, you see that when Ananias prays for Saul, the Bible says he received the Spirit. See? It is the Spirit that quickeneth. In other words, it's the Spirit that gives life. You can't fulfill purpose on your own. Purpose can only be fulfilled by the anointing power of the Holy Spirit on your life. On your life. You and I can discover everything that we want to discover about life and our purpose, but until you are anointed by the Holy Spirit to do it, you're not going to be able to fulfill it nor carry it out. You will quit in the process. But if you are anointed to do it, no matter what comes your way, no matter how tough it might be, you will find a way through the Spirit's leadership to carry out the purpose and fulfill God's mandate for and upon your life. Okay, one last scripture, and then I'll be done. All right, Galatians chapter 1, verse 1 through 24. I'm going to try my best not to read all of this, so I just want you to kind of hang in here, and I want you to get a hold of this. Now, after Paul leaves Damascus, he's run out of town, basically. Folks are like, whoa, get rid of him. He got to go. So he's run out of town. And so since he's run out of town, now where does he go? Well, the scripture picks it up over in Galatians chapter number 1, and it tells us exactly where he went. Okay? So listen to what it says in Galatians chapter 1, verse number 1. It says, Paul, an apostle, not of men. I love this. Now, this is set off in parentheses here so that you and I know that it wasn't written in the original text. But it's important to understand that this is important because he's not an apostle of men. In other words, when you see the 12 apostles that are foundational apostles, Paul is not one of them. No. He has Ephesians 4 on his life. He has the gift of an apostle, okay? So there's a difference between foundational apostles and those that are gift-driven apostles. Paul is a gift-driven apostle, okay? All right? So he says this, Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. Verse 2, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from the present evil world according to the will of God our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, verse 6 says, I'm amazed that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace. That's the grace. That's what he's talking about. His message. His message given to him by God was a message of God's grace. Okay? Into God, in the grace of Christ unto another gospel. In other words, there were people who were coming along who were also attached to the old season. People who were saying, you have to be this like the Hebrew people in order to know God. And Paul is saying, no, that the Gentile people are drafted in, that we are drafted in. Yes, the Hebrew people have their relationship with God, but we are drafted in, meaning we don't have to keep ceremonial laws. We don't have to keep the 613 laws that kind of run around and govern us. And again, there are compass. There's a moral compass that comes from the Ten Commandments that we know provides framework for us living a life that is centered in God. But we're not going about trying to keep Ten Commandments. We're not trying to keep the other 603. Here's what we're doing. We're living by the grace of God, and we're allowing the Holy Spirit to be our teacher and our guide on all things God. That's the grace of God. That's the grace of God. That's the grace of God. Now watch this. I gotta close this down, so I want to get to the point. Look down to verse number 10. Let's go there. All right, go to verse 9. I'm sorry. Go to verse 9. As we said, therefore, so say I again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that you have received, let him be accursed. Verse 10. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after a man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by revelation of Jesus Christ. It was revealed in Paul what his purpose was. Just like it said over in Acts chapter number 8, that, hey, here's what I've called him to be. I've called him to be an apostle that is going to be sent to the Gentiles, to kings, and to the children of Israel. Man, what a revelation that you can build a personal relationship with God to the extent that God will reveal to you what your purpose is in life. And you have to shift from old season in order to see what God is really doing in your life. Listen, he goes on in verse 13 and 14. He says, for you have heard of my conversion in times past in the Jewish religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God, and not only that, but I wasted it. I persecuted it so bad that I wasted it. Verse 14, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. He is talking about Mosaic law. He said, man, I was so attached to last season that I did some things, man. I persecuted the church of God and I wasted it. And I was blind to it. Let me ask you that question. Are you blind to what was? Or have you made your shift? Are you blind to what was? Is what was blinding you from seeing what God is doing by slightly changing your whole world? Yeah, it's tough. But we all are shifting. We all are changing to and becoming adaptable and flexible so we can see what the will of God is for our lives. Verse 15, and I'm done. 15, but when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace. Why? To reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, the meaning of the Gentiles. Immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. Verse 17, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them that were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again into Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter, and I abode with them 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none, only James, the Lord's brother. Listen, I want you to hear this. This is important. In order to shift your purpose, you're going to have to spend time with God. I want you to notice what he said in verse number 18. He says, after 3 years, he spent 3 years in Arabia. My God, 3 years he spent in Arabia, set apart, hearing from God. Before he went about preaching any message, he wanted to know, what is my purpose? And that's what I want to say to you tonight. You've got to find your purpose now. You got to shift. Because God is doing something fresh, new, and relevant on this side of COVID that you're not going to be able to bring your old experience into this. Yes, this is going to require some sackcloth and ashes. This is going to require some prayer time. This is going to require fasting. This is going to require getting along with God until you are no longer by yourself, until he shows up in the room. It's going to require that. Paul spent those 3 years before he even went and came into contact with Peter, and he came into contact, spent 15 days with him. He said, I didn't see any of the apostles. I saw Peter, and then I saw the Lord's brother James while I was there. But I was already purpose-driven when I showed up to meet them. I showed up with my mandate, my call on my life, and I had to shift from old covenant. I had to shift from the Hebrew relationship with God, and I had to have a spirit-filled relationship with God. I hope you get this tonight. Hope you get the fact that you have to shift. You're going to have to come out of what was. I don't know what that was that you were before. Only I can know what I was before COVID-19. And I can say to you with clarity tonight that I'm a different pastor. I'm a different guy going about ministry in a whole different way. And it's required of me by God to become that. But I can't get stuck in a season. And it's too easy to do that. If you're stuck in a season tonight, I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you to have enough fortitude to have a revival with God and have God to refresh you. And you can declare, like Jesus did in Luke 4, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he hath anointed me to preach. And whatever your call is, it don't have to be preaching the gospel, but whatever that is, it can be in business, it can be an educator, it can be in law, it can be in medicine, and the list goes on and on and on. But whatever God have called you to, let it be by the Spirit. That's my prayer for you tonight. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that we're shifting. I thank you, Father, that we are shifting in our priority, we're shifting in our perspective, and we're shifting in our purpose. And we ask you, Father, to help us to have this okay with ourselves, to make a slight change in our position, to make slight change in our direction. Help us to know that it's okay to make a slight change in our direction. Help us, Father, to shift. Help us as we return together. Help us to have a greater expectation in this new season that we're in. Help us, Father. We lay it all on the altar. We sacrificially lay it all on the altar. And we ask for your help to reveal in us, like you did Paul, what our mandate and purpose is. Thank you for doing this. Thank you for helping us. Thank you for helping us to shift our purpose so that we can bring your kingdom glory in these times that we live. We glorify you for it and thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. What a joy. What a joy. Hey, listen, if you want to give tonight, you can. The text to give is coming up on the screen. Praise God. Man, we are shifting. We're shifting, man. We're shifting. We're locating God. God moved on us since COVID. And we're locating with the very position of God. We're seeking God. We're seeking God. We're seeking God. And as we're seeking God, man, God is revealing his presence to us and showing us what we ought to be doing in these last days of COVID-19 to prepare for this upward swing of life. Praise God. So go ahead and follow those instructions that you see before you. If you want to give, you're on our website, you click that link there that says give. If you want to join this church tonight, you click the link that says membership. If you want prayer for anything, you can send your prayer request in by simply clicking on the prayer link that is provided there for you. If you want to receive Jesus Christ as personal Savior as well, you want someone to lead you to Christ, you do that through our prayer request as well. Send us a little note. Just send us a little note through your prayer request, letting us know that Jesus Christ is Lord over your life, letting us know how we can stand in agreement for you and your family during this time as you are shifting to know what God's mandate and purpose is for your life. I pray this lesson bless you tonight. I pray it open up the eyes of your understanding, that you are enlightened to know God's perfect will for your life. God bless you. Until Sunday at 8 a.m. and 10 o'clock a.m., stay in the faith and know that God is shifting your purpose. God bless you.
We believe your word. We receive your blessing. We believe everything that you say. Amen. It is so. It is so. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Oh, Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. May he give you peace. We respond. Oh, amen. 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 Amen.
In your family, in your children, in
let children may say, hey,
be a part,
and your thousand generations. He is for you. He is for you.